I'm going to apologize a little bit because I'm going to take a different route here and maybe change the way things that we're doing a little bit. Today's really been on archaeology and the Hopewell culture as well as the Adena culture, which it ought to be. I was assigned to come in today for some reason or another that I don't know. But I'm going to change that focus a little bit and push it into a scriptural or a Book of Mormon type of proof. I do archaeology. My interest really lies in Middle Eastern archaeology and in particular Egyptian archaeology, and am trying to put together even some works now about the gospel in Egypt, things like that, the different things that show up in Egypt and some of the religious texts that are found there that relate to biblical as well as LDS studies and religion. So that's what I really enjoy more than anything else, but I enjoy scripture. And the Book of Mormon is part of that. And so the research that I do within scripture includes all of the what we consider scripture. Today I'm really going to kind of focus, I'm going to try and keep the main theme on North America as a setting for the Book of Mormon. But I'm going to do that not from an archaeological point of view or the Hopewell culture, that type of thing, but actually from the scriptural text. And so I'm going to talk about the prophecies and promises that are made in the Book of Mormon that will discuss freedom and, in a manner of speaking, the Constitution. I want to look at some of these prophecies and promises. So if you'll bear with me, it's mostly scripture. When I was doing research, I was told that I could use scripture itself, I could use the standard works, I could use the statements of the prophet Joseph Smith, and I could use the statements of prophets that prophets made while they were prophets, not before, but while they were prophets. And so I kind of stick to that standard, and the standard that I have really come to fall on is that of the standard works, because even the prophets have said that if even what they say does not square with the standard works, then you can rest assured it's their own opinion. So the scriptures really become my standard. And so most of what I'm going to present is going to be verses from scripture with some explanation, but I want you to be able to see the whole picture. When you study scripture, when you study a particular topic that deals with scripture, the first thing you do is you take all of the scriptures that pertain to that particular topic, and is what I do is I print them out, and then I spread them all over the floor so I can see the whole thing. And then I start arranging them into topics or into subjects and subheadings. But I can see them all, and that's the way I like to do it. And so what we're going to go through today is part of that, a result of part of that process. When Lehi comes to the Promised Land, this is the first thing that he says. When he lands on the Promised Land, or as he understands about the Promised Land, he says, "We have obtained a land of promise, which is choice above all other lands, a land which the Lord God hath covenanted with me." And this is the important part that I want you to remember, that should be a land for the inheritance of my seed. And then he says that there's going to be others, and also all those who should be led out of other countries by the hand of the Lord. "Wherefore I, Lehi, prophesy, there shall none come to this land, save they shall be brought by the hand of the Lord. Wherefore this land is consecrated unto him whom he shall bring." That tells us we're talking about the Promised Land, and in particular, and about those groups of people who are going to come to that Promised Land. It's special. It's set apart. There's a reason for it. There's a reason for its existence. And and the Lord is in control of what's going to take place there. And so he tells them, Lehi, right from the very beginning, it's for his inheritance, and it's going to be for people who are led out of other countries. Well, the Promised Land, the promise of the Promised Land, you can talk about prophecies and promises within the Book of Mormon. You know, over half of the prophecies in the Book of Mormon, more than half, considerably more, almost 80% of the prophecies in the Book of Mormon are about the last days and about the people on the Promised Land in the latter days. About 80% of the prophecies in the Book of Mormon are about people that are going to be on the land after Mormon and Moroni write that record. We talk about, and I'll mention it a little bit later. It is a chosen land. And what is it chosen for in the Book of Mormon? It mentions a number of things. One, that it's going to be the place of a new Jerusalem. Two, it's going to be protected from other nations, other people. It's going to be a land of freedom, so to speak. It also tells us in there that the Savior will come to that particular land and visit those people that are descendants of Lehi. There's going to be a record kept about that promised land. There's a reason that you need to have that record kept. When you think about the Bible and the Old Testament, what's the record for? It is a testimony of Christ. But it is also a record of a fallen people. When you think about the Old Testament, it is a record of a fallen people. It goes from one conquering to one destruction to another with the Lord's people. There's a reason for that. There's a reason that that record is there and that that record needed to be kept so far as Scripture goes. And a key element in the Book of Mormon is that that promised land, or one of the promises of that promised land, is it's going to be a land of liberty. Well, we're going to go through each one of those. We're going to run through New Jerusalem first, protected from others, Christ visiting, and a record to be kept, and the land of liberty. Now, I want to do that, so bear with me as we go through these scriptures. The first one is talking about the New Jerusalem upon this land. Now, this comes down in a number of instances from Moroni in Ether as he's translating the record of the Jaredites, and then even in Nephi and in the words of Christ in 3 Nephi. He says, after the waters have receded off the face of the land, this is Moroni translating and abridging the Jaredite record, it became a choice land above all other lands, a chosen land of the Lord, and it was the place of the New Jerusalem, which had come down out of heaven. Ether saw the days of Christ, and he spake concerning a New Jerusalem upon this land. Now, we've talked about the phrase last year, the phrase this land, because a demonstrative means when you say this land, it means the land where the speaker is speaking. So it can't be misconstrued, because it always answers the question of which. It goes on to say that a New Jerusalem should be built upon this land under the remnant of the seed of Joseph, again in Ether. Wherefore, the remnant of the house of Joseph shall be built upon this land, and it shall be a land of their inheritance, and they shall build up a holy city under the Lord, like unto the Jerusalem of old. So it's talking about, again, a New Jerusalem is going to be upon this land. This land is that land that was promised to Lehi. That promised land. That's one of the promises. Christ says in 3 Nephi, he says that the Gentiles shall assist my people, the remnant of Jacob, and also many of the house of Israel shall come, that they may build a city which shall be called a New Jerusalem. Those are his statements. That's key. One of the key elements within the Book of Mormon is this New Jerusalem. It is going to be a center place, a particular place, a chosen place. The other, that it will be kept from the knowledge of other nations. We read in 2 Nephi, as they land on the land, as they come to that land itself, this is when they get off the ship, they're on the land, Lehi begins his prophecy, and he says, behold, it is wisdom that this land should be kept as yet from the knowledge of other nations. For behold, many nations would overrun the land, that there would be no place for an inheritance. Now, this is the area where they land. Wherefore, I, Lehi, have obtained a promise that inasmuch as those whom the Lord shall bring out of the land of Jerusalem shall keep his commandments, they will prosper on the face of the land, and they'll be kept from other nations, that they may possess the land unto themselves. There's a reason for that, and that was the first statement that we read, because it shall be a land of their inheritance. And if it so be, they shall keep his commandments, they shall be blessed upon the face of this land, and there shall be none to molest them or take away the land of their inheritance, and they shall dwell safely forever. So it's going to be kept from mass knowledge, so that they can have an inheritance, so they can keep it, and so they can live there safely. It doesn't say that they will be the only ones on that land, or the only ones there, or the only ones that may come and go, but they will be there safely. It's not going to be overrun. It says the seed of Lehi will be visited by Christ on the land, and we have that in 1 Nephi 13. For behold, thus saith the Lamb, I will manifest myself unto thy seed, and they shall write the many things I'll minister unto them, which shall be plain and precious. And after thy seed shall be destroyed and dwindle in unbelief, and also the seed of thy brethren, behold, these records shall be hid up to come forth unto the Gentiles by the gift of the power of the Lamb. So he says, he's going to come and he's going to visit. And when he's there, or to the people that are there, they are going to keep this record so that it can go forth to those who are going to remain, the remnant. There's always a remnant, as well as the Gentiles who are going to come upon the land. So the record needs to be kept for that. And when you go through these, you find out that they're all connected to the land. For some reason, they are all connected to the land. In Doctrine and Covenants section 3, we read for one of the reasons or the purposes of the record being preserved. It says, for this very purpose these plates are preserved, which contain these records, that the Lamanites might come to a knowledge of their fathers, that they might know the promises of the Lord, that they may believe in the gospel and rely upon the merits of Jesus Christ. So that's one of the key, that is basically the key reason we have the Book of Mormon. It contains the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ and goes hand in hand with the Bible, the Old and the New Testament, and testifying that Jesus is the Christ. That's the key purpose of the Book of Mormon. In Mormon, as he's ending the record, he begins writing that a knowledge of these things about the record must come to the remnant of these people and also the Gentiles. So the record now has to go to two people. It always had, just as it says in the title page of the Book of Mormon, for the convincing of Jew and Gentile that Jesus is the Christ. And so Mormon, he's the last one. He has an unusual point of view, as does Moroni. Most historians that we have today, most people who write history, are not writing at the end of a civilization with all of their records available so they can actually tell you what caused the end of that civilization. But Mormon and Moroni have that opportunity, if we can call that an opportunity. But they have a point of view at the end of a civilization when no one is left there to read the record. There is no one yet going to be there that is contemporary with Mormon and Moroni that will read that religious record. And so they are writing actually for a different people and a different time period, and he tells us the remnant of these people and also the Gentiles, who the Lord has said should scatter this people. I write a small abridgment. And he says, I want to talk to them. That's the remnant and the Gentiles, and also those Gentiles who have care for the house of Israel, those who realize and know from whence their blessings come. I'm going to talk to that remnant. I want to speak to that remnant and those Gentiles who know and understand the gospel of Jesus Christ, who know from where those blessings come. This is a message to those people in the latter days, because there's nobody left to read the record. Mormon goes on. Now, these things are written to the remnant of the house of Jacob, that they are to be hid up unto the Lord, that they may come forth in his own due time. They shall come forth according to the commandment of the Lord, and when he shall see fit in his wisdom, and for this intent they shall go, that they, that's the remnant and the Gentiles, everyone, may be persuaded that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and also that the seed of this people may more fully believe in his gospel, which shall go forth unto them from the Gentiles. So he's making that connection again, back to Israel, and or the remnant that will be saved, and to those Gentiles. And that is one of the purposes of the Book of Mormon, that that gospel go forth. Well, the record goes on to say, in Mosiah, it says, the Nephites shall leave a record behind them, and I will preserve them for other nations. Now, this is unusual that this record is kept for this reason, which shall possess the land. Other nations which shall possess the same land. Yea, even this I will do, that I may discover the abominations of this people to other nations. And Mosiah 28, and they, the records, have been kept and preserved by the hand of the Lord, that he should discover to every creature who should possess the land the iniquities and abominations of this people. That's another purpose. That's why in the Doctrine and Covenants it says, and we'll read it here in a minute, it says that it contains the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ and is a record of a fallen people. Now you have to ask yourself, if this is true, what is the purpose of us in the latter days? We know what the purpose is to have the gospel. What is the purpose of us having a record of a fallen people? That begins to make it personal. There's a reason for that. Why do we, and who's going to read it? Have you seen the Book of Mormon on the New York Times bestseller list? Sometimes I wonder if it's on Deseret's bestseller list. But who reads it? We read it. It's written for the readers of the last day. And the readers are not those who don't have it, believe it, or accept it. It's written for the readers of the last day. And the book is written that the readers of the last day have a record that will discover the abominations of the people who have been on that same land. And you have to ask yourself why. When you read it, you don't say, oh boy, I wish all those non-members out there, or those non-Mormons, they really ought to read this book. It wasn't written to the non-Mormons out there. It was written to the Mormons. So that we can have a record of the abominations of this people. So that we can read and understand every creature who should possess the land, the iniquities and abominations of the people who were there before. Why are they gone? And why do we need to know and understand what caused their demise? Keep the same thing. Why do you think the Old Testament contains doctrines that are true, like the gospel, but yet the Old Testament is really a record of a fallen people? For the same reason. Isn't it odd that when you think of Scripture as Scripture goes, you think of Scripture that the Lord provides Scripture of fallen generations and nations that knew and understood His Word? Why does He do that? Those are some of the terrible thoughts. Well, anyway, section 20 says the record contains, it's a record of a fallen people, and it contains the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ to the Gentile and to the Jew also. So again, here's the purpose of the Doctrine and Covenant, or the Book of Mormon. The key purpose is it's got fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's a message for everybody. Then it's a record of a fallen people. That's a message to Latter-day Saints. And there's one other message, but we're going to talk about that tomorrow. There's another message in there. But first, it's a message to the world. It contains the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ that goes to the world. It's a record of a fallen people who once knew or who know and understand the gospel of Jesus Christ so that they can preserve the very prophecies and promises that are taught in the Book of Mormon so that we don't have to go through the same thing, so that we can understand. That's one of the key reasons. It'll be a land of liberty. And this is key throughout the Book of Mormon from the very beginning to the very end. 2 Nephi 1 is the prophecies of Lehi as he begins. Wherefore, this land is consecrated unto him whom he shall bring, and it shall be a land of liberty unto them. Wherefore, they shall never be brought down into captivity. But if they are, it shall be because of iniquity. For if iniquity shall abound, cursed shall be the land for their sakes. But unto the righteous it shall be blessed forever. So he's giving us some key elements there. This is one of the reasons right here that it will be a land of liberty. In order for it to remain a land of liberty and never be brought down into captivity, we have to have a record of a fallen people. If you look at all of the rest of the prophecies and promises collectively. That's why I spread them out. When I look for a subject, I spread them out all over the floor so that I can look at it. Now, if the prophecies and promises, if I can jump off here a little bit, I'm going to talk about it later. Maybe I'll talk about it later. Let's go on. It still needs to be a land of liberty. In Alma, we read the foundation of liberty, which blessing God had set upon the face of the land for the righteous' sake. It's not liberty because of the righteous. The liberty is guaranteed. It's on the land if the people are righteous. It's something that remains with the land, and that is clear throughout the Book of Mormon, that the liberty and freedom is placed upon the land. And we can either do those, we can either follow the restrictions and stipulations, or we don't have to. But it's placed upon the land, upon the face of the land for the righteous sake. And therefore, at this time, Moroni prayed that the cause of the Christians and the freedom of the land might be favored, that it might remain, that it might be there. I'm going on. Oh, that was the last one, wasn't it? No. Came to pass that when he had poured out his soul to God, he named all the land, this is Moroni, Captain Moroni, a chosen land and the land of liberty. In Ether we read, whatsoever nation shall possess it shall be free from bondage and from captivity and from all other nations under heaven. the prophecies and promises are about the land itself. The record, the Book of Mormon is a record of different migrations of people. It is a record that contains the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's a record written to reveal why a group, a fallen people, were destroyed. And it's a record written specifically about a promised land. It is a history of the people who come to that particular land. And it becomes a record about the very land that they come to. And that's what it's trying to tell us here. In D&C 10, this is after Joseph Smith loses the 116 pages. He's given the Urim and Thummim back for a little while so that he can receive this revelation, somewhat of a chastisement, but of a revelation. And the Lord starts talking to him about things that he had not yet translated. He only did those first 116 pages that went up to the time of King Mosiah. And the Lord begins talking to him about some of the prophecies and promises that come later in the Book of Mormon. And he says, "This work does contain all those parts of my gospel which my holy prophets and also my disciples desired in their prayers should come forth unto this people." Now you can either say, well, that's the Lamanites, or you can say that's the Gentiles. As Joseph Smith said, we are the ones identified with the Gentiles in section 109. "Their faith, their prayers," this is the ancient ones, "their faith and their prayers with this gospel should be made known also, if it were possible, that other nations should possess this land." Now that means where Joseph Smith is at now. "And thus they did leave a blessing upon this land, that it might be free unto all of whatsoever nation, kindred, tongue, or people they may be. And now behold, according to their faith and their prayers, I will bring this part of my gospel and to the knowledge of my people, for this cause I have said, if this generation harden not their hearts..." Now he's speaking, he's quoting himself in 3 Nephi, and he's speaking specifically about the Gentiles, because in 3 Nephi, where Christ actually states this, he says to the Gentiles, "I will establish my church among them." But he says that it must be free, that it might be free. And he says this is what the ancient prophets had prayed for, and the righteous anciently had prayed for, that if something happens to them, that the gospel would be preserved, and that the people that would come to a land that would have freedom guaranteed, so that the gospel could come forth and the Book of Mormon could be revealed. And he says here, the church be established. Now this is a statement from Christ here in 3 Nephi. He says, "These works and the works which shall be wrought among you hereafter shall come forth from the Gentiles unto your seed." Speaking, he's talking about their history and their words, their writings are going to come forth unto the Gentiles to your seed. "For thus it behooveth the Father that it," the Book of Mormon, or the fullness of the gospel, "should come forth from the Gentiles, that he may show forth his power unto the Gentiles. For this cause, that the Gentiles, if they will not harden their hearts, that they may repent and come unto me and be baptized in my name and know of the true points of doctrine, that they may be numbered among my people." So he's telling us that this is something specific for the Gentiles in the latter days. Now remember, this is an abridgment by Mormon after no one is left to be able to read it. Mormon is putting this information in the record. And then he says, "If they," the Gentiles, "repent and hearken unto my words and harden not their hearts," this is the quote that he gives in Doctrine and Covenants 10, "I will establish my church among them, and they shall come into it, unto the covenant, and be numbered among the remnant of Jacob, whom I have given this land for their inheritance." So he says that those Gentiles will be able to receive, or the church will be established among those Gentiles, and they will be able to receive an inheritance on that same land. Again, this is Christ speaking. He says, "For verily," in 3 Nephi 21, "for verily I say unto you that when these things which I declare unto you and which I shall declare unto you hereafter of myself shall be made known unto the Gentiles, that they," the Gentiles, "may know concerning this people who are a remnant of the house of Jacob, concerning this my people who shall be scattered by them, when these things shall be made known unto them," that's the Gentiles, "of the Father, and shall come forth of the Father from them unto you," the remnant. And then notice what he says here, "For it is wisdom in the Father that they," the Gentiles, "should be established in this land and set up as a free people by the power of the Father, that these things might come forth from them unto a remnant of your seed. Now, if we will take the assumption and premise that North America is the setting for the Book of Mormon, what is this particular scripture telling us? Why do we have a constitution that guarantees our freedom? What was the purpose of founding fathers, of Puritans and Pilgrims coming here out of captivity for religious freedom? What was the purpose that this land needed to be free and set up as a free people by the power of the Father in order that these things might come forth from them? Which things? The gospel of Jesus Christ, the Book of Mormon, the restoration, and the establishment of the church. That's the whole purpose. That's one of the key purposes that we today live in a free land. Now we need to understand that for tomorrow's lecture, or tomorrow's discussion about this, because we're going to jump off a little bit different. But in my opinion, the United States exists as a free country for a place for the restoration of the gospel and the coming forth of the Book of Mormon, the establishment of the church, according to the Book of Mormon. That's why it needed to be set up, and we needed to be set up as a free people, that these things might come forth. The very purpose. If that is the purpose, our freedom hinges on righteousness and responsibility that's described and talked about in the Book of Mormon. Man, you're somber. Is it really that bad? Am I that depressing? I thought it was Paul, but I think it's me now. Well, the promised land must be free. In the Doctrine and Covenants, we read the laws, speaking to the Constitution. Now, we know it says that the previous verses that we just read said that the land must be set up as a free land, and the people, the Gentiles, must be set up as a free people, as it does in the Doctrine and Covenants, as a free people in order that these things may come forth. And speaking of the Constitution, the Scripture says, and the laws and constitutions of the people, which I, the Lord, have suffered to be established, should be maintained. Should be maintained for the rights and protection of all flesh, according to just and holy principles. Therefore, it is not right that any man should be in bondage one to another. And for this purpose have I established the Constitution. Again, he's using the first person singular, the Lord. For this purpose, the Lord has established the constitution of this land by the hands of wise men, whom I, again, he raised up unto this very purpose. And the land has been redeemed by the shedding of blood, in order that these things might come forth. That's tomorrow's discussion. That's tomorrow's discussion, is how do we hang on to it? Going on, DNC 98, not 109 and 98. Have mercy, O Lord, upon all the nations of the earth. Have mercy upon the rulers of our land. May those principles which were so honorably and nobly defended, namely the constitution of our land. Now this is Joseph Smith. He's not speaking of some other place. Of our land by our fathers be established. He's saying, namely, the constitution of our land by our fathers be established forever. That it is a requirement. It's one of those restrictions and stipulations that we as Latter-day Saints need to be aware of and familiar with within Scripture. DNC 98 says, and that law of the land, which is constitutional, supporting that principle of freedom in maintaining rights and privileges, belongs to all mankind and is justifiable before me. And our Constitution has become a pattern of many constitutions in the latter days in the Organization of Nations. DNC 98, therefore, I, the Lord, justify you and your brethren in my church in befriending that law which is the constitutional law of the land. And as pertaining to the law of man, whatsoever is more or less than this, lest than this cometh of evil. And I, the Lord, make you free, therefore ye are free indeed, and the law also maketh you free. Nevertheless, when the wicked rule the people mourn. It happens all the time, and history. That's why we have records of a fallen people. What we see in the Book of Mormon, what we see in the Old Testament, along with the way the people are, the way their characters are, the way their nature are, we see the examples of wicked rulers throughout both Testaments, the Old Testament as well as the Book of Mormon, the results of wicked rulers. Well, how is the Lord going to set up this land as a free country and a free land? The Book of Mormon is a history of three migrations. Is that right? What are they? Let's make this interactive a little bit. Jaredites, Amalekites, and the Lehites. Could say Nephites, but Lehites include the Nephites and the Lamanites. Is that right? That's wrong. If you look at the Book of Mormon, you will discover that it is a history of three migrations, but a prophetic record of four. And the fourth? The Gentiles that come out of captivity. It is a historical record of three migrations. It is a prophetic record of four migrations. Because the history was written by prophets. Therefore, the history is a prophetic history. And the four migrations that come to this land is a prophetic history that goes beyond their time. And as you go through the Book of Mormon, you see over and over and over again the discussions about the Gentiles who shall come upon this land. Mormon, the last, and his son Moroni, the very last Nephites to abridge that record, were not writing for the Jaredites or the Amalekites or the Lehites. They were writing for the world, because it contains the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. They were writing for Latter-day Saints, because it contains a record of a fallen people. And they were writing for the nation that will live on the promised land that is non-denominational. For the gospel to the world, a record of a fallen people, for those who know and understand the gospel, and again, to maintain freedom to everyone who lives on that promised land. And there's only one way that everyone on the promised land can get that information. It's from those who read the record. Okay, 1 Nephi 13. And it came to pass that I beheld the Spirit of God that wrought upon other Gentiles. We're talking about how was the land going to be made free. That other Gentiles went forth out of captivity upon the many waters. Is there any question about who that is? Cortez really doesn't fit the bill for me, because he wasn't coming out of captivity. Every commentator, every discussion on this particular verse always talks about the Puritans and Pilgrims who came for religious freedom. I don't think there's any question about that. And especially when you add the other, and I beheld that their mother Gentiles were gathered together upon the water and upon the land also to battle against them. What war is that? The Revolutionary War. I don't believe there's any question about that. They are coming. I mean, they are coming to the very same land. This is discussing the land because it's the prophecy about that group of people. It's the prophetic prophecy about that group of people that's going to come to the same land. Well, it goes on. I beheld, in 1 Nephi 13, I beheld that the power of God was upon them, that's the Gentiles, who came out of captivity, who is now battling against their mother Gentiles, that the power of God was with them, and also that the wrath of God was upon all those that were gathered against them to battle. And I, Nephi, beheld that the Gentiles that had gone out of captivity, that's a key phrase here, were delivered by the power of God out of the hands of all other nations. There is no question where that is and what that means, who that, what people that is, and what land they came to in order for that freedom. And he says in 2 Nephi 10, "This land, saith God, shall be a land of thine inheritance, and the Gentiles that we just talked about in 1 Nephi 13 shall be blessed upon that land." Well, it's going to be without kings. It's going to be a land of liberty to those Gentiles. We're going to go through these very quickly. And I tried to keep these scriptures, only about two of them that I used twice. So all of these scriptures you see, most of them you're only going to see once on here, because I don't want to repeat and make you think that I'm using the same one, even though you can use the same one for multiple discussions. "This land, saith God, shall be a land of thine inheritance, and the Gentiles shall be blessed upon them. This land shall be a land of liberty, and there shall be no kings upon the land who shall raise up unto the Gentiles. And I will fortify this land against all other nations." 3 Nephi 21, "It is wisdom in the Father that they should be established in this land and set up as a free people." That's one of those repeats, because it is important that this land was established and the Gentiles had to be set up as a free people in order that that gospel could come forth, the church could be established, and the restoration take place. The freedom needed to be on that land. It talks about the Gentiles back in 1 Nephi 13. "I beheld the Spirit of the Lord, that it was upon the Gentiles, and they did prosper and obtain the land for their inheritance." Remember Nephi's prophecy and Lehi's, that the Gentiles would obtain the land for their inheritance. And here's the same thing, that they did prosper and obtain the land for their inheritance. This is that prophetic history that had not happened yet. That's this fourth migration that is to come to that promised land. "And I beheld the Lord had reserved the Nephites' blessing, which they might have received in the land for the Gentiles who shall possess the land." Now, what does that tell you about the lands? They're the same. Because the Nephites, that record of a fallen people, the blessings that the Nephites could have had on that land were preserved for the Gentiles who were to come to that very same land. And it's all the prophecies and promises about the promised land. What blessings of the Nephites are reserved for the Gentiles? Well, in the Doctrine and Covenants, so far as inheritance, we read, "And I hold forth and deign to give unto you greater riches, even the land of promise, a land flowing with milk and honey." These are the same phrases used in the Book of Mormon and in the Old Testament, "upon which there shall be no curse when the Lord cometh, and I will give it unto you for the land of your inheritance, if you seek it with all your hearts." That means there's a responsibility. If you seek it with all your hearts, demands responsibility. "And this shall be my covenant with you. You shall inherit it for the land of your inheritance and the inheritance of your children forever." But there's a responsibility there. If you seek it with all of your hearts, there's a requirement placed upon it. That land that is promised, flowing with milk and honey. The Gentiles be blessed upon the promised land. Nephi 14 here, 1 Nephi 14. "If the Gentiles shall hearken unto the Lamb of God in that day, he will manifest to them himself unto them in word and also in power and very deed." This is talking about the restoration. "They will be numbered among the seed of thy father. They shall be numbered among the house of Israel. They shall be a blessed people upon the promised land forever." The same land. Talking about the Gentiles on the same land. "They shall be no more brought into captivity, and the house of Israel shall no more be confounded. I will soften the hearts of the Gentiles, wherefore the Gentiles shall be blessed and numbered among the house of Israel. And I beheld many multitudes of Gentiles upon the land of promise." It grows and grows and grows. The responsibility is still there because the prophecies and promises are connected to the land itself. Even though the masses increase, the responsibilities, prophecies, and promises are connected to the land itself. The restrictions and stipulations placed upon the Jaredites, the Nephites, are the same for the Gentiles in the latter days. So if you go through the scriptures, you will find that the same restrictions that the Jaredites had, the same restrictions that the Nephites had, are the same restrictions placed upon the Gentiles of the latter days that will live upon the same land. The Lord did pour out, and these are some of the restrictions, "The Lord did pour out his blessings upon this land, which was choice above all other lands, and he commanded that whoso should possess the land should possess it unto the Lord, or they should be destroyed when they were ripened in iniquity." It doesn't limit that to anybody. Whosoever should possess the land. 2 Nephi 10, it is a choice land, saith God unto me above all other lands. Wherefore I will have all men that dwell thereon, that they shall worship me, saith God. That's why I say that that third group that the Book of Mormon is written to, the first, to everyone in the world, because it contains the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The second, to the Latter-day Saints, because it contains a record of a fallen people who knew the Lord. And the third, it's written for everyone who lives on the promised land, Jew and Gentile, Mormon, non-Mormon, in order to know and understand the restrictions and stipulations placed upon that land to maintain freedom, to maintain that freedom that is guaranteed by prophecy and guaranteed by promise from the Lord. And the only way that everyone can understand that on the land is by a responsibility placed upon those who know what those prophecies and promises are, what those restrictions and stipulations are. Moving on, and the Lord had sworn in his wrath to the brother of Jared that whoso should possess this land of promise from that time henceforth and forever, that includes our day, should serve him, the true and only God, or they should be swept off when the fullness of the wrath should come upon them. And now we can behold the decrees of God concerning this land, that it is a land of promise, and whatsoever nation shall possess it shall serve God, or they shall be swept off. For behold, this is a land which is choice above all other lands, wherefore he that doth possess it shall serve God or be swept off. For it is the everlasting decree of God. That is one of the stipulations and restrictions that are placed upon the land that everyone on the land needs to understand and know about. Not just the Latter-day Saints. Not just the Latter-day Saints. Remember this promise we read of Lehi. We have obtained a land of promise, a land which is choice above all other lands, a land which the Lord hath covenanted with me should be a land for the inheritance of my seed, and also those who would be led out of other countries or lands. I prophesy that there shall none come except they're brought by the hand of the Lord. This is what Lehi says as he gets on the land. See, it's 2 Nephi chapter 1. That's when they've landed. He's now standing on this land. Not that land, but this land. He's standing on this land, and the Lord tells him that it's land for his inheritance of his posterity and others who are going to come here. The restrictions are for the land that he's on. Going on, we learn in 1 Nephi 13, as Nephi has the prophetic vision of the fourth group, those Gentiles, he says, the Gentiles who have gone forth out of captivity and have been lifted up by the power of God above all other nations upon the face of the land which is choice above all other lands. See, that says you cannot be mistaken about where that promised land is. And then he makes sure that you can't be mistaken by saying, which is the land that the Lord God hath covenanted with my father that his seed should have for the land of their inheritance. He has made it so that we cannot, by prophetic history, by prophecy, we cannot misunderstand where that land is. If we do not know and understand where the setting is for that promised land, every prophecy and promise written in the Book of Mormon is of no value. Because of the restrictions, the stipulations, and the information that is given in the Book of Mormon, if we cannot understand, if there is not enough information in the Book of Mormon so that we cannot make a mistake where that land is, then every prophecy and promise about that land of promise is of no value, is null and void, if we do not know where it's at. The prophecies and promises about the Gentiles in the promised land in the last days are founded upon those in the last days knowing where that land is. The Book of Mormon would not give us those prophecies and promises if it did not. It would not give us those restrictions. It would not give us those stipulations unless it provided enough information to know exactly where that land of freedom and liberty actually is. Mormon and Moroni would have failed in their message to the Gentiles of the last day in writing about the Jaredites and what caused the fall of the Jaredites and what caused the fall of the Nephites. They would have failed in their message to the people of the last days if we cannot discover within the text itself where that promised land is. Anyway, the Gentiles will become a mighty nation upon the land. I'll raise up a mighty nation among the Gentiles, even upon the face of this land. These things which I declare unto you, which shall I declare unto you hereafter, these are going to come. The Book of Mormon exists. Not the Book of Mormon, but the people must exist as a free people in order that the restoration may take place. The title of liberty on the promised land. We all often talk, we like to talk within the church about chiastic structures, you know, something at the beginning, something at the end, something in the middle shows a chiastic structure. When you look at the Book of Mormon, why did Lehi leave Jerusalem? There was going to be destroyed. By whom? By Babylon. Why was Jerusalem going to be destroyed? Because they were wicked. You realize that when Joshua and Moses brought the children of Israel into the promised land, that they gave them the exact same restrictions that we find in the Book of Mormon. The exact same restrictions. So Jerusalem was being destroyed because the prophecies were being fulfilled and the promises were being fulfilled in the Old Testament that if they did not worship the God of the land, who is Jesus Christ, that they would be destroyed and wiped out. Lehi is leaving because that prophecy, those promises are being fulfilled to the kingdom of Judah. Because Babylon was coming out of the east and was going to destroy it physically. But the reason the temporal Babylon was going to destroy Jerusalem physically was because Jerusalem had embraced spiritual Babylon. So the Book of Mormon begins with destruction by spiritual Babylon. How does it end? Destruction by spiritual Babylon. What Lehi fled for the safety of him, his religion, his family, what he fled was what destroyed his posterity. Now, right in the center, there's something very interesting. That's a title of liberty. Right in the center of the text. And what does it say? It's talking about the leaders at that particular time led away the hearts of many people to do wickedly, yea, to seek to destroy the church of God and to destroy the foundation of liberty. Now, it's what that is doing. It's connecting religion with liberty. It's connecting faith, righteousness, with freedom, which God had granted unto them, or which blessing God had set upon the face of the land for the righteous sake. And it came to pass that Moroni rent his coat, and he took a piece thereof and wrote upon it, in memory of our God, our religion. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our freedom and our peace, and then our wives and our children. And he fastened it upon the end of a pole and called it the title of liberty. Right in the middle of the Book of Mormon, we have a title of liberty. And in my opinion, the Book of Mormon is not only a title of liberty, but a title to liberty on the promised land. Because the Book of Mormon, from beginning to end, is about this: our God, our religion, our freedom, our peace, our wives, and our children. Our faith, our freedom and our families. Because freedom and faith are connected. And the only way that we can ensure spiritual and temporal protection for our families is to maintain the freedoms that are directly connected to God. Anyway, what is our responsibility? But that's tomorrow. That's what we're going to talk about tomorrow.